Well, good morning, everyone. How you doing today? Pretty mediocre. All right, great. It's good to see you all this morning, and it's a gorgeous day. Way to go, getting into church right on time. My name is Dave. I'm one of the pastors here and want to just take a couple of minutes to do a couple of things. First of all, I want to say welcome. If you're new to a worship service here or just come a few times, we love that you're here and would love the chance to say hello. We've got a welcome table in the lobby, and I'm going to try to be out there afterwards. Would love to see you, and we're glad you're here today. And for everyone else, if you come regularly, we want to encourage you to connect through our Connect card. Now, it's not actually a card. It's a trick. It's digital. But you can get it through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, which is found on Church Center is the app. But why do we do that? Why do we keep saying that? Because we want to know that you're here. We want to know how we can pray for you. And in addition to that, on the app, you can find out what's going on in the church and find sermon notes and all kinds of good stuff. So I hope you'll take advantage of that. We're heading into a holiday week, aren't we? So I don't know. Hopefully you get a little downtime, maybe a day off in there somewhere. I want you to know that as a church staff, we have requested our church staff to take off some time. And so what we're going to do is starting tomorrow, from the 1st to the 12th, we're going to encourage our staff to take some time off. Have you ever been in that spot where you're like, you're at work, but the other people aren't, so you can't get stuff done? Or they're at work and you're not, so you feel like you should keep checking your email? We've learned that if we all take a break for a little bit, it's really a healthy restoration and to be refreshed and ready. Now, you need to know next weekend, service times, normal, no change, same 5 o'clock Saturday night, 10 o'clock Sunday. And if something comes up, you need a pastoral contact or something's happening and you need the church, you can go to the church website, go to the elder page, and there will be a mechanism there to let your need be known, and our elders are ready to respond during that time, all right? So a lot of weeks we pray for other local churches right now, but today we thought, let's pray for our church. So why don't we all stand together, and I'll pray as we start our service for the Lord's work in and through our church. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, what a beautiful day. What a great reminder of your grace, your goodness to us. And so we just say thank you for life, thank you for breath and strength, and thank you for this opportunity to worship you. Lord, we pray for our church that you would be leading every aspect, that you would keep us dependent on you and focused on you, effective for you. Lord, we pray for our staff that there'd be a good pause and refreshment so that we can get back at it with full energy and investment. And Lord, just in this service, we ask that your name alone would be praised, that you would draw each of us closer to you. We commit this time to you. We want to give you our best energy and attention right now. We pray all these things together in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. All right, let's worship the Lord.
Oh, is your kingdom, here and yet to come. The God of creation came and dwelt with us. What a Savior, what a friend. And Jesus, you triumph over the curse of sin and death. You rescued the helpless, and you call us citizens. So we join the saints in worship to our God. Church, we sing this out together. Hallelujah to the one most worthy. Hallelujah to the King of glory.
I love in Psalm 115, it says, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be all the glory. Church, that's what we came here to do, to give God complete glory. So with every fiber of our being, let's sing this out together. With every breath, I'll worship you, God. In life or death, the victory's won. For who you are, and all that you've done, oh, the praise is yours. Yes, it is. We give you all the praise. With every breath, I'll worship you, God. In life or death, the victory's won. For who you are, and all that you've done, oh, the praise.
Praise God. stand in awe of who you are, God. Let us never come into your presence, God, without worship, without praise, without reverence, God. You are a holy God. And you rule and you reign, God. And that gives us hope for our lives to know that our God reigns and that there is nothing outside of your control. We love you, God. We worship you today. In Jesus' name, we all said, amen. Amen.
Psalm 96 says, ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering, come into his courts, worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness, tremble before him all the earth. This morning we've had the opportunity to bring our worship of time and attention and saying the first part of the first part of my week will be in the Lord's house because he's worthy. And I want to sing these songs that I know are true of him because I want to ascribe worth to his name. And I want to receive his word because it's his life to me. And I want to give because it's a tangible, practical, personal way to ascribe worth to the Lord. So as we consider right now our offering to the Lord today, remember why. Because he's worthy. Remember who this is for. Remember how we're to do it joyfully as unto him. The mechanisms are helpful. Those are on the screen. But honestly, it's the motive that matters most. Our God is worthy. Let it be, Lord, that my life, my singing, my time, my calendar, my money reflects your worthiness. You are above all. And so I want to pray and commit our offering to the Lord together. Heavenly Father, I think it's an incredible thing that you invite us to bring an offering to you because we do not enrich you in any way. And yet, it's right for us to say that you are Lord and we are not. And it's right for us to joyfully give and to participate in what you're doing. And thank you, Lord, that when we give, you help break the bondage that money so often has over our life and reminds us that you are our treasure and you are enough. And thank you, Lord, that when we give to be a part of what you're doing and to see more men and women and children drawn to our Savior, Jesus Christ. So, Lord, would you receive our gifts and our worship today, that you'd be pleased and that you would accomplish your purpose through them. Thank you that we get the opportunity to be a part of what you're doing. And we belong to you because of Jesus. We commit all these things to you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we have junior hires in our church. Is that not great? And this morning, junior hires are invited to step out and to come with Larry. They're going to have a great time in the Word and connection together. There's usually some food. Isn't there some food, Larry? There's food. So you can, Pastor Larry's right over here, or you can take a walk with him. The junior hires will be in the junior high room. We invite you to go. It'll be way more fun than being stuck in here with all of us older people. So, all right. Now, the rest of us, why don't we take a moment, just turn around and greet somebody and say, hey, I'm glad that you came to church today. At the point in our service where we're going to get into God's word together, and it won't be Pastor John speaking, and it won't be Pastor me preaching today, but we're really truly grateful to the Lord for a guest speaker today. His name is Scott Phelps, and Scott has been in our church through its history, a pastor here, an elder here. He served the Lord faithfully. He was also part of a super hard chapter in our church where, frankly, our leaders, we made the wrong estimations, the wrong decisions, the wrong words towards him and some others. By God's grace, that's clear to us. By God's grace, forgiveness has been sought. Forgiveness has been granted. All of that is God's grace. But in God's grace in that, Scott's going to bring God's word to us today.
Yeah, I think of a verse in 1 Corinthians that says, "Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord." And I think of Scott and how he's been greatly used in his ministry of God's word into public schools, of God's work into lives of families. I also think of Dan Marquardt, who's here today, and Barry Slabaugh, who's here today. And I'm thankful for them because they have been doing the work of the Lord outside these walls for many years. And that steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord should be a testimony to God's grace and his kindness and how that all works together on a day like today. So I'd like to pray for Scott just before he comes up here. And would you join me in that time? Lord, I am so grateful that we get to open your word today and we get to see what it is that you have for us, that we might be able to ascribe more worth to you, that we might be able to live in a way that demonstrates you are alive and at work. And so, Father, I pray that you would be with Scott as he opens your word. I pray that you would give him boldness. I pray that you would give him clarity. I pray that you would use him in a mighty way to strengthen us as we draw our attention to you. And so, Lord, thank you for this time that we have. Use it greatly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, Pastor Jeff is not here today, but he'd like to extend a welcome. And so why don't you direct your attention to the screen?
I've been at Harvest 3 years now. And when I first came, the reason I did come was because the church was in a pretty difficult state. The church, doesn't matter which church you're part of, the church often goes through ebbs and flows of great moments and sad moments. There are things that we as church leaders look back on and we wish we would do different. If we had our time machines, we'd go back and change our decisions. And there are things that we look back on, we think, what a great idea that was, usually because the Lord made it work, not necessarily us. We have a really great opportunity today to see a kind of renewal happen right before our eyes. About 10 years ago, the elders at the time at Harvest Bible Chapel made the decision to disfellowship a few elders. As those elders have looked back, many of them have reflected and said that was not a good moment for our church and have really wanted to show their heart of renewal and restitution and restoration and all those good things. And so today, we actually have asked one of those former elders who was disfellowshipped to come back and preach to us. He was on staff here for a year and a bit. He actually came and he merged his church with Harvest's in those early days and was a really important part of what was going on in those early days. And then things went a bit wonky. So he's going to come and he's going to preach to us today. He's become a good friend. His name is Scott Phelps, and we just want to welcome him. Would you join me together in welcoming our dear brother back to Harvest Bible Chapel, Scott?
You don't even know. You don't even know how excited I am to be here today and how thrilled I am to see what God is doing in this place. I feel like there's an entirely new spirit, it's a new day, and I am just excited. I have watched from afar. You know, Ecclesiastes 3:11 says, "He makes all things beautiful in his time." I joined the pastoral staff here 27 years ago. I've been gone for the last 11 years, and it's good to be back. And I'm thrilled that Barry Slabaugh and Dan Marquardt are here as well. You all look great, by the way. Have you been working out? You haven't changed a bit. I saw Mike Parenti last night. He still looks like he's 14 years old. But I am thrilled to see you all here today, and I am especially thrilled to meet your new pastor. Jeff Bucknum is a wonderful, godly man. You know, I didn't know how it would be possible for God to resurrect this church after it crashed, because it did crash. And it went through a very difficult season. And Dan and Barry and I and some others were outside looking in saying, is there any way? Is there any way that this church can come back? I don't see how. How do you find someone? Well, God has found a wonderful, humble, godly, tremendously gifted communicator in Jeff Bucknum, and I couldn't be more excited that he is here. I hope that you pray for your pastor. It's not easy to do this. Jeff's really, really good, and so it looks easy, but it looks easy because he works hard at it. To be able to preach well, you've got to be gifted by God, and you got to do your homework, right? And this is 2 Timothy 2:15, study to be a workman that does not need to be ashamed. A good preacher is a workman. He works hard. And he works hard, and I hope that you will pray for him. Were you here for the message where he did the one on Jesus going and preaching to the spirits in prison? I mean, I never understood that passage. I do now. If you didn't see that message, go back and watch it. It was so good, and there was so much in it. That message, there was so much in that message. When I was done, I felt like I just finished a deep dish pizza, ate the whole thing. I mean, I felt like I didn't need to go to church for 3 more weeks. It was that good. And I will tell you what, if you have not been following along this series, it's all on the internet, and you should go back and watch the whole thing. It's been a fantastic series, and I have the honor of landing the plane today as we come to the close of the passage. I've been watching online. I've been watching all of the messages. Ironically, the title of the series is Strangers in a Strange Land. I don't feel like a stranger today. I feel like I'm home, and I'm thrilled to be here. And before we jump into 1 Peter, I do have to make one other comment about the book of 1 Peter, because whenever you say 1 Peter to me, my heart skips a beat. It goes a little pitter-patter. Because when I was in college at San Francisco State University, I was a president of InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, and I was leading Bible studies on the college campus as a college student. And you know how it is in college, you know, students are coming to Bible study, but they get busy, and they've got finals, and they don't always show up. But there was one person who was always there, always there, and her name was Carrie Flack. And she is now Carrie Phelps, and last Sunday we celebrated 40 years of marriage together. And she is the love of my life. I thank God for her. She's an amazing woman with her own ministry to children and five-day clubs and good news clubs and all that she does. And I'll tell you what, I am a different person because of her, and I thank God for her. I love you, sweetheart. I love you. I think of what Erwin Lutzer says, by the way, about marriage. I love the way Erwin Lutzer puts it. He says this. He says, marriage is two people working together to solve problems that they never would have had if only they'd remained single. Oh, he's good. He's good. All right. Hey, we got to get to work. And I've got to speed up because last night I went way too long. I was so embarrassed. I was just having too much fun with y'all. But we've got to tighten it up. And so we got to get to work. Open your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 5. We're going to land this plane. And what I want to do is I want to try to, the reason I took a long time is because I'm trying to do kind of a global overview a little bit of the book and then the particulars of this last chapter. And so I want to do that now in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 through the end. In fact, last night, I think I went so long, I think the worship team stayed overnight. Did you guys stay overnight? 1 Peter chapter 5. Let's get to it. Let's find 1 Peter. There we go. 1 Peter chapter 5. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls about like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. By Silvanus, a faithful brother as I regard him, I have written briefly to you, exhorting and declaring that this is the true grace of God. Stand firm in it. She who is at Babylon, who is likewise chosen, sends you greetings, and so does Mark, my son. Greet one another with the kiss of love. Peace to all of you who are in Christ. Now, just a note there in verse 12, Silvanus is the same Silas that we know from Paul's epistles. He's the FedEx driver delivering the letters, and that's why he is referenced here. He may have also been Paul's scribe, but probably at least delivering the letter. Now, for big picture, I want to step back, and I want to look at chapter 4 for just a moment to give. As I looked through the book, I thought, what is the one passage I could look at that maybe best summarizes and gives kind of a pull together of where we're at in the book? And I think chapter 4 does it well, because there's a lot about suffering in the book. And in chapter 4, it says, the first three verses says, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking, for whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. Nothing that we can relate to today. Speaking of which, I spent this week in San Francisco, which is my home, and I was there for a government conference. And our ministry, the National Marriage Campaign, we do a lot of work with the government, we work with public schools, we work with health departments, different agencies and so forth. And so from time to time, there are these government conferences that we go to, connect with people and so forth. And so I was in San Francisco, and you know, it's San Francisco month, you know, so there's all over the rainbows, the pride stuff and everything everywhere. And so I'm at this meeting in downtown San Francisco, and the lady in this meet and greet thing that I was at, she says, I want everybody to introduce themselves, and the way I want to do it is I want you all to play a song on your phone that tells me something about you. So, you know, the different ones are going around the room, and this one's Tupac, and this one's Beyonce, and this one's Taylor Swift, and all these different people, and I'm sitting there thinking, what am I gonna choose? And so here's the song that I chose. I asked them to play just the first minute of it. Go ahead.
I saw mercy, mercy seated where the judge should be, was guilty. Guilty and getting out of jail free. How could it be I didn't get the life I deserved? And the only thing he wanted was my heart in return. And every time I think about it, every time I thought was the end, I'm caught up in wonder again. Where would I be? Where would I be if it wasn't for the love of God?
If it wasn't for the love of God.
Oh yeah. This song of victory is now mine to sing, hallelujah, for the love of God has set me free.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, for the love of God.
Just a minute. Yeah, good. So that's the song I played, and then I said, this is my home. I grew up here. And I don't know what my life would be like. I don't know where I would be if it wasn't for the love of God, because God reached down and rescued me. He picked me up and he lifted me up out of worldly living. And my life is so different today because God got a hold of my life. That's my song. And I just think, yeah, go ahead. You can give a hand to the Lord for that. What about you? Where would you be? Where would you be if it wasn't for the love of God? And what Peter is doing in this letter is he's talking to a people who've been called out of, as it says in the text that we just read, it's been called out of a worldly lifestyle and set apart. And so God has done a work in your life, and that's now who he is talking to. Now, the title of our message today is Living in Babylon. I get the term from verse 13, where he says, she who is in Babylon, who is likewise chosen, sends you greeting. Now, what does he mean by Babylon? Well, he can't mean literal Babylon. Why? Why can't he mean literal Babylon? Because there is no Babylon. Isaiah the prophet, this blows me away, because Isaiah the prophet, writing at the height of the Babylonian Empire, says, you're going down. God is going to judge you, and God is going to take you down, and you will never be restored. You Google up today. You want to go to Babylon? Google it up. It's a little spot of dirt. There's nothing there. It is gone. So Peter can't mean literal Babylon. It was long gone by the time he's writing. So what does he mean? Well, if you go to your footnotes, your study Bible notes, it will probably say he's talking about Rome. Maybe. I'm not convinced. I'm not sure it was Rome. And my point there is just to say this. Understand, always make the distinction between the text and the study notes. Text is inspired and inerrant. It is absolutely true. Study notes, not so much. The study notes are really smart people, but they may not be right. And as I study the word, I'm just not so sure that the evidence for Peter being in Rome is super strong. Now, the Catholic Church believes he was in Rome, and St. Peter's is built on top of where they believe Peter was buried, right? That's why St. Peter's is in Rome. It's because the grave of St. Peter. Only problem is Scripture never mentions that Peter went to Rome. In fact, Peter's kind of a homebody. He's not a world traveler like Paul. Paul went everywhere. Peter, not so much. He kind of hangs around the house. In fact, in Acts chapter 8, when the church is scattered for persecutions, is everybody left except who? Peter. Peter and the apostles. They hung out. They stayed in Jerusalem. So even for Paul, world traveler, it was pretty tough to get to Rome. He writes in Romans, he's like, I'm trying to get to you guys, but you're pretty far away. So there's just a lot of reasons why I'm not sure of that. And I think sometimes the reason I'm mentioning any of that is, be a Berean, do your own study of the text, see that there's nothing in the Bible that actually says Peter was in Rome, and then ask yourself the question, well, then why is he, and even if he is in Rome, why doesn't he just say Rome? Why doesn't he just say the church at Rome? Why does he say Babylon? Some people say, well, it was code language. What, so the people you're writing to knew the code, and the people that were the bad people didn't know the code? I just don't get it. So here's the thing. Sometimes when we chase after things that aren't in Scripture, we miss the main thing. And as I read the text, I wonder if the reason he's using Babylon is merely because it would recall to the exiles that he's writing to, chapter 1, verse 1. He's writing to the exiles that their minds would be taken back to the actual exiles in Babylon. Jeff did mention this earlier on. And if you go to Jeremiah chapter 29, you will see what I'm talking about. I think this is kind of what Peter's getting at. In Jeremiah 29, we read, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their produce, take wives and have sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters, multiply there and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city to where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find welfare. And I think that it may just be that what Peter is doing is saying, he's kind of doing the same thing as Jeremiah. Jeremiah is in Jerusalem writing to the exiles in Babylon, because you know, not everybody went to Babylon. As Jeff would say, they took the smarty smarts. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, people like that. They took the younger smarty smarts and they moved them to Babylon, but then they left a lot of the older people and the infirm, and Jeremiah was one. There were a lot of people got left behind in Jerusalem. And Jeremiah in 29 is writing to the exiles saying, listen, while you're there, you're going to be there for a long time. Don't listen to the false prophets. There's more in the text. Don't listen to the false prophets that are saying 2 years, it's going to be 70 years. You're going to be there a long time. And so when you are in Paganville, when you are in Babylon, when you're living there, build houses, take wives, have families, be a blessing to the city, for in the blessing of the city will be your welfare. So you, when you're living in Babylon, should be model citizens. You should be having families and being an encouragement and being a blessing. That's how you should live in Babylon. And I think that's what Peter is alluding to here. That in his letter, he's saying the same thing to the exiles that are dispersed. And he's saying, listen, even though it's hard, even though it's difficult, be a blessing in that place. I think that's what he's saying. Now, a lot in the book is going to allude to the teachings of Jesus. So Jesus in Matthew 5:16, for example, says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and what? And glorify your Father who is in heaven. Look at how Peter says it in verse 2:12. Peter says this. Listen to how, you'll see this a lot in Peter, how he will sort of paraphrase Jesus. He's alluding to the teachings of Jesus. A lot of what he's sharing is what he heard from Jesus. 1 Peter 2:12, keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God in the day of visitation. See, it's the same as what Jesus is saying in the Sermon on the Mount. And so I think when Peter is talking about living in Babylon, she who is in Babylon sends you greetings. That's where he is. That's where they are. We're all in Babylon. We're all living in Paganville. Keep your conduct excellent so that the people around will see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. I think that's what he's saying there. And so that is, by the way, what Peter is doing here. What does he say in 3:15? Sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make a defense for everyone who asks you to give a hope for the hope that is in you, yet with what? With gentleness and reverence. See how he's instructing us how to live in Babylon? You should have Christ sanctified, set apart in your heart, and when people see the joy in you, when they see the hope in you, share with them that hope, that joy, that radiance that you have, it's Jesus. And just share it with gentleness and reverence and be a kind, sweet, loving person in sharing the gospel. That's how you live in Babylon. That's what he's saying. There are many allusions to the teachings of Jesus. And that is where the letter of Peter is different than the letters of Paul. Peter hung out with Jesus. He was with him for 3 years. He lived with Jesus. Paul didn't. And so a lot of what Peter's doing then is sharing what he saw and what he learned. For example, chapter 5, verse 1, he says, I was a witness of the sufferings of Christ. I saw it. I was there. And then flip over to chapter 2. I love this one in 2 Peter 1:18. Peter says, for we did not follow. Oh, and I'm not using the smart board over here because it looks like a lot of fun, but I didn't have a chance to sort of practice and make sure that I know what I'm doing, so I didn't want to do that. But if Jeff has me back, I'll use the, because it looks like a lot of fun. I want to try it out. We'll do that next time. All that to say, you got to flip the pages. Sorry, I don't have it up on the screen. 2 Peter 1:18, "For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we were eyewitnesses," there it is, "we were eyewitnesses of this majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, 'This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased.'" Listen to this. "We ourselves heard this very voice born forth from heaven. For we were with him on the holy mountain, and we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed." What's Peter saying? I was a witness to Jesus. I saw it all. In fact, I had this blow you away moment. Peter, James, and John, the three of us, we went with Jesus up on the mountain. Oh my goodness, you should have been there. It was amazing. I saw him transfigured. I saw Moses and Elijah. It blew me away. Now, years later, as an older man, that's the thing that really sticks out to me. It was amazing. You should have been there. But then at the end, he says, "But we have this more sure word." What is the more sure word? Right here. And what he's saying is, as cool as my experience was, I was totally hanging out with Jesus. Me and Jesus, we were tight like that. Even though I had that really cool experience that you all wish that you could have, there is something even more sure. That was a very cool moment, but it was a fleeting moment. And there is something far more sure than that, because, like, for Peter's like, the next day I was like, did that really happen? We have a more sure word. And what's nice about having this is that we are able to have the Word of God so that we can put it on our shelf in our house, and every morning as we walk out the door, we can wave and go, "Hey." Or maybe we can take it off the shelf and open it up every day and feed our souls with the Word. And that's what Peter is saying. We have the more sure Word of God, and that it is that feeds us. All right. So all of Jesus, Peter's teaching is rooted in what he has heard and learned and the inspiration, of course, of the Holy Spirit. And now let's get into, we got to dig into the text here, starting in verses 6 and 7. All right, first point. We're just getting to the first point. How's my time? I got to watch this. All right, first point is verse 6. The Lord cares for you. Look at the verse. "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him." Here it is. "Because he cares for you." Think about that. You like to be cared for? I like to be cared for. Who cares for you? God cares for you. The one who created heavens and earth, the transcendent, eternal God of all creation, he cares about you. He knows you intimately. In fact, so what I want to say here about this too is Jeff made a very clear distinction and a helpful distinction between the imperatives and the indicatives. Do you remember that one a few weeks ago? Imperatives are do this. Humble yourselves, cast your anxieties, do. Those are imperatives. But then there are indicatives, which are simply statements of the way things are. He cares for you. And the reason I'm making that distinction is because I started out my outline with the imperatives, be humble, cast your anxiety, right? But I think it's far better for us to focus in on the indicatives of what the reality is, and the reality is God cares for you. You don't have to humble, you don't have to puff yourself up, because there is a God who will exalt you in due time. Now, when I think about this passage, this phrase, he cares for you, it takes me back to the very beginning of this series, chapter 1, where Jeff did the elect exiles message. If you didn't see that message, at least see that one, the first one. It was a fantastic introduction to the book. And what was particularly gripping to me was Jeff's exposition, best exposition I've ever heard, of the term foreknowledge. Go back to chapter 1 for just a moment. Let's review that. In chapter 1, verse 2, It says, according to the foreknowledge, there it is, according to the foreknowledge of God. And this is the key. The key is that God knows everything about you. Jeff made the point that the foreknowledge of God isn't, it's not so much that he knew in advance. There's an aspect of that, but it's richer than that. It's deeper than that. It's more significant than that. That to know in Scripture carries a relational component that's very real. So, for example, throughout Scripture, it'll say, like, Adam knew Eve, and she conceived a son.
Thank you okay? for listening to the weekly sermon podcast.
It's an intimacy. To know someone is to have a deep, intimate relationship with them.
For one of our campuses, go to harvestbible.org.
And so foreknowledge is
Tune in
that.
Again next week for
And this whole letter starts off in verse 2, writing to those who are elect, to whom God has a deep, intimate, personal relationship. And so we have to pull over the car right here and get out for a minute. We need to have a little come to Jesus talk. Literally. Do you have that? Do you have a genuine, personal, intimate, I've got to be in the Word, I've got to worship, I've got to praise Him? Do you have a deep, real, intimate, personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Because here's the sad thing to me. There are people who will go to church regularly, but have never actually come into a relationship with Jesus Christ. They've never yielded their life to Him. And so what I'm wanting to ask you this morning before we go any further, because listen, the whole book is based on verse 2. It's written to those who have an intimate relationship with Him. And if you haven't done verse 2, nothing else in the book applies. But the good news is it can apply because that relationship is available to everyone. Who are the elect? The elect are those who respond to the gracious invitation of salvation. You say, well, where do I get that invitation? You're getting it right now. God is calling you right now. The writer of Hebrews says, today if you hear His voice, harden not your heart. Submit your life to Him. You turn over the keys of your life. You say, I'm done trying to do it. Everything I've done has failed. Everything I've tried hasn't worked. Lord, I yield my life to You. I turn over the keys. Here, take the keys. Take it. You do it. I can't do it anymore. That's what it means to come into relationship with God. You turn over the keys of your life to Him. Have you done that? See, there has to be a moment in time. You don't have to remember the day, but if you've done that, you haven't forgotten it. You know it. If you've given your life to Christ, you know it absolutely because He's changed your life inside out. You are not the same person you used to be. There's been a dramatic change in your life as a result of Christ turning you around, lifting you up out of the world. And I'm just wanting to make sure as we bring this book to a close that we're very clear that number one, God, who created you, wants to have a relationship with you, and the offer is extended to you today. And at the end of the service, we're going to have some of the leaders of the church up here up front, and I'm just asking you today, don't walk out those doors without knowing for sure that you've turned over the keys. Just come up front and turn over the keys. Whoever is up here, you come, you talk to them, say, I'm here to give God the keys to my life. I hope you'll do that today. It's so important. So important. It's the most important thing. God wants to know you and have an intimate relationship with you. I love the way David puts it in Psalm 139, where he's talking about it. He says, even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all together. You hem me in behind and before. You lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is so too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot. David says, it blows me away. It blows me away to think that the eternal creator of the universe wants to have an intimate relationship with me. It's amazing. Jeremiah, you know, I always misread Jeremiah 1:5. I thought Jeremiah 1:5 said this. I thought it said, when I formed you in the womb, I knew you. It doesn't say that. Jeremiah 1:5 Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. What? It doesn't say when you were in the womb, I knew you and consecrated you and called you. It doesn't say that. Before you were in the womb, that blows my mind. How was that possible? You knew me before I was, what? God knows more about you than Google knows about you. I'm serious. So when I say the Lord cares for you, that's what we're talking about. That's what we're talking about. He cares for you because he knows you and he loves you and he sent his son to die for you, for God so loved the world. And that's you. See, when you understand the indicative, the Lord cares for you, everything else falls into place. I don't have to be proud. I have to puff myself up, elbow myself to the front of the line. I can humble myself knowing what? Knowing that there is a God who loves me and cares for me and will exalt me in his time and in his way. I'm trusting in him. I understand he cares for me. And I can cast all of my anxieties. We all have anxieties. I can cast all of my anxieties on him because he knows. He knows what I'm going through, and he cares for me, and he loves me. He's got this. And so understanding the care of the Lord, I can turn everything over to him. And isn't this what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 6 in the Sermon on the Mount? When he says that the birds of the air, he talks about the birds and the lilies. I tell you, don't be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink or about your body, what you'll put on it. Is life not more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. Your heavenly Father feeds them. And he goes on and on. And what is Jesus saying? Listen, listen, listen. You don't have to be worried and freaked out about stuff. God cares for the birds. He cares for the lilies, and guess what? He cares a whole lot more about you. He takes care of them. He's got you. He's got you. The Lord cares for you. There's no one else who can care for me more. God loves you and cares for you more than you can. God cares for you more than your mother cares for you. He loves you. All right, let's get on to the second. I can't move on yet. One more point. Because what's the flip side of that? What's the flip side? If you don't know that there's a God, then yeah, you got a lot to worry about. And you've seen the reports of the young generation and the mental health and the depression and all the stuff that they're stressed out about. They go to school, they're told there is no God, the planet is dying and it's your fault. All the stuff that's being pressed down on our kids, the social media, all of that. Our kids are in a world of hurt. Sex education in our schools, you don't know if you're a boy, you don't know if you're a girl, you're so confused right now. Our ministry, the National Marriage Campaign, we exist to supplant and replace sex education in American schools. That's what we're trying to do. I believe sex education is harmful. Yeah, it's corrosive. Thank you. Sex education is corrosive to the national soul. It's killing our kids. And I bring it up here because Peter is saying, cast all your anxieties on him, for he cares for you. But if you don't believe there is a God and you're listening to all the noise of the world and you're drinking in all the Babylonian juice, you're going to be in a world of hurt, and our kids are hurting right now. And they need Jesus. They need Jesus. I'm so thankful for my mother-in-law, who has taught Child Evangelism Fellowship in the San Francisco area for 50 years, reaching children with the gospel. My grandmother was taught Sunday school at First Baptist Church of San Francisco for 60 years, teaching little ones. My wife does an amazing work leading good news clubs and five-day clubs at the elementary school and middle school in our area. We've got to reach our little ones. We've got to share with the next generation the love of God, the love. They have to know that. They're hurting, and they need to know the Lord. They need to know that the Lord cares for them. All right, let's move on. And now the next point's kind of funny. All right, so we go from the Lord cares for you. Point two. What's point two? The devil's after you. That's what it says. That's what it says. Right after he says, don't worry, the Lord cares for you. What's the next verse say? Verse 8, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls about like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. Wow. So don't worry, cast all your anxieties on him, but watch out, the devil's coming for you. Now, he calls the devil a roaring lion. I don't know a lot about lions. Never met a lion. I have never met a lion. Bears are another thing. I got to throw in a little story here for Jeff, a little BC story, British Columbia. I grew up in San Francisco, met my lovely wife at San Francisco State University, and when I was in college, I think it was my senior year, me and two buddies, we drove up to central BC, British Columbia. We went straight up the middle of the British Columbia, got to Williams, hung a left, drove 300 miles on a gravel road to the Pacific Coast, Bella Coola, British Columbia. I'm talking middle of nowhere. We didn't see another person there. We were there to go fishing in the Bella Coola River. And when we got there, and it was fall, so there was no people, just no one anywhere. And it was beautiful, by the way. And when we got to the camp area, there were signs everywhere. Watch out for the bears. There's grizzlies here. They live here. You're in their house now. You're in grizzly bear territory. And so there's all these signs around, you know, watch out for the grizzly bears. And so I go down to the banks of the river to go fishing, and I'm not kidding you, there are footprints in the sand at the river's edge this big with big fat paws all over the place. And it's just like a cartoon. You know what else is strewn along the riverbed? Part of the salmon. The head, the tail, and all the middle was gone, just the bones. You know, if you can just picture that. The tail, the head, and a bunch of bones. There's bears here. And all over, you just see these, you know, these eaten salmon and the footprints and everything. And so they told you on the signs and in the literature they give you, they say, make a lot of noise because you don't want to sneak up on a bear. So one time, I went to go fishing by myself because they, you know, you're still sleeping, fine, I'm going fishing. So I get up and I go down and I'm hiking down to the riverbed and I am singing at the top of my lungs the hallelujah chorus. Hallelujah, ha! And I'm doing all the parts. I got the soprano, the alto, I got it going on, you know. And I look over and all the bears are standing. No, I'm just kidding. So I'm just singing at the top of my lungs. And trying to make as much noise as I can, you know, and ruffling the bushes and everything. And I'm not making this up. Here's how I went fishing. I mean, it was like so intense. We slept in the tent. My friend had a 30-06 rifle laying next to the sleeping bag. And we would hear something in the middle of the night. What's that? What's that? It was really peaceful. We were watchful. We were alert. And here's the thing, watch this. I never saw a bear. I never saw a bear. But I saw the evidence of the bear. First of all, I had the warning signs written down for me. There's bears. And I saw the prints. I saw the works. Listen, I don't see the devil. I see the deeds of the devil and I have the warning of Scripture. It says in Scripture, the devil is real, he is your adversary, and he's coming for you. And Peter knows what he's talking about. Turn to Luke chapter 22, we have to look at this. Peter knows what he's talking about, because in Luke 22, and this blows me away, this passage, 22:31, Simon, Simon, Jesus says to him, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to have you that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. Peter said, Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death. Jesus said, I tell you, Peter, the rooster will not crow this day until you deny me three times that you know me. Later on in verse 60, third denial, Peter says, man, I do not know what you're talking about. And immediately, while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. And look at this, verse 61. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Oh. Peter remembered the saying of the Lord, how he had said to him, before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times. And he went out and he wept bitterly. Do you know what blows me away about this passage? First of all, that Satan demands permission to sift you like wheat. But what really blows me away is that Jesus doesn't say what I want him to say. He doesn't say what he's supposed to say. Jesus doesn't say, hey, Peter, listen up. Satan has demanded permission to sift you like wheat. But no worries, I got this. I'm going to stop him. See, that's what Jesus is supposed to say. That's what I want him to say. What does he say? I'm praying for you. What? Hey, Peter, Satan's coming for you. I'm praying for you, man. Now, here's the thing. Here's the thing that really gets me. Think about this. In any situation, there's several different options, right? You've got A, B, C, D. Does Jesus never picks D and then he's like, oh, I went with D. I should have gone with D. Jesus always picks A. What is A? It's not stop the devil. What is A? Prayer. The very best thing Jesus says I can do for you is pray for you. You don't think prayer works? You don't think prayer matters? I don't know if you're like me, but, you know, I get texts from my family all the time. You know, it's like, I've got a test tomorrow. I got a doctor's appointment tomorrow. I got something tomorrow. Please pray for me. Okay, and I stop and I pray and I got to be honest. Sometimes I'm wondering, you know, does it? If you don't think prayer works, you're not reading your Bible. Because Jesus says the very best thing I can do for this in this situation is pray for you. And he doesn't even pray to stop the devil. You're going to be sifted like wheat, Peter. He's coming for you. And I'm praying that your faith may not fail you. And after the devil gets after you, I'm praying that you'll get up again, that you'll get back on your horse, and that you will strengthen the brothers, and that in Acts chapter 2, you will stand up in the middle of Jerusalem where I was crucified after you denied me in that place, and you will stand up and you will preach the gospel, and thousands of people will be saved. And then years later, as an older man, you're going to write to Christians all over the world. And through generations and generations and generations, people are going to be taught and encouraged and blessed by you. I'm praying for you, Peter. When you've turned again, strengthen the brethren. And that was Jesus' prayer. Not that the devil would be stopped. Has Satan demanded permission to sift me like wheat? I got to be ready. I got to be watchful. I got to be like this. I got to be eyes wide open because the devil wants to take me down. And I got to have faith and strength. It says resist him firm in your faith. We can resist the devil. All right, very important that we understand the importance of prayer. Verse 10 does talk about remembering the suffering of your brothers. I need to mention, I'd be remiss not to mention that today is the day of the Christian martyr. Today, we remember 10 years ago in Mosul, Iraq, is when ISIS took out many Christians. 100,000 Christians had to flee their home for persecution. Peter is telling his brothers, listen, there's people suffering all over. There are Christians today suffering for their faith. We may not be experiencing it here right now, not like that, but there are many who are. We need to remember them. We need to pray for them. And there's all kinds of Christian suffering. I'm thinking of my friend John Porter, who's a member of this church, who for the last 4 years has been back and forth to the hospital. He just had a double lung transplant a couple weeks ago. And it's been very difficult for him since COVID. Pray for him regularly. It's been so tough. Many of you are going through difficult times. I understand that. I hear that. And I just want you to be encouraged today that God loves you, He knows you, He cares for you, and that prayer matters, and that in times of suffering, we pray to the Lord. He hears our prayers, He answers our prayers, and He answered this prayer for Peter in a big way. All right, I got to move. Point number three, let's get to it. Lord cares for you, devil's after you, and here it is. You are called to eternal glory in Christ. Excuse me, what? You are called to eternal glory in Christ. And this is like where Paul says we have this light, momentary affliction, which is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory. In other words, yes, you're suffering now, but it is only for a season. You will spend eternity in relationship in the glory of Christ. It's going to be amazing. I'm going to call this one, this third point, the grand indicative. Indicatives are true statements. The Lord cares for you. That's a true statement. The devil is after you. That's a true statement. Here is the grand indicative. You are called to His eternal glory in Christ. Wow. Wow. When I have that kind of perspective, it changes everything about the way I live. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can handle any situation. I know where I'm going. My destiny is secure. I know where I will be. Just as in Hebrews 12, 2, Jesus, it says, we're looking to Jesus who for the joy set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and now is lifted up and seated at the right hand of God, and you're going to be with Him. We are strangers in a strange land, but it is only for a moment. We're going home, and we are going to be with Him in His eternal glory. I love that song by Building 429. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I belong. I don't need to put down roots here because my home is heaven. It is secure. So stand firm. He says, receive the true grace of the Lord. And now finally, verse 14, peace to all of you who are in Christ. This is the whole letter, by the way, verse 14. Peace to all of you who are in Christ. When you turn over the keys of your life, when you submit your life to Him, then and only then can you actually live your life in peace. This is the whole letter. You have peace because you are in Christ. And if you are not in Christ, here's the good news. You can be in Christ today. At the end of the service, come down front. Turn in the keys of your life. The message of the letter of 1 Peter is that when you are in Christ, you can have peace in your life, even if you're living in Babylon. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. It is a tremendous encouragement to us. I don't know how people live their lives without the word of God, without a relationship with you. I pray for those who are outside the kingdom, who have happened in here today. I pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would tug at their hearts even now, that they might enter into a genuine, lifelong, eternal relationship with you. I commit them to your care. I pray for these dear saints here at Harvest Bible Chapel, Lord. Would you bless them and encourage them in their walk with you day by day, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. What an incredible message. Thank you, Pastor Scott. Let's stand together. Church, we're going to respond by having a time of worship and communion. If our ushers can come forward to get ready to pass out the elements. Communion is a time to remember the love of Jesus and how far He went to show His love for you and for me. Communion is a family meal for those that have put their hope and faith in Jesus. And if you haven't put your faith in Jesus today, we kindly ask that you let the elements pass. And as we have our moment with worship and communion, that you would consider following Jesus today. And as the elements are being passed, we'll sing this song as a response to his love for us. Hold on to the elements, and as we finish singing, we'll take the elements together. Let's sing this out together.
Oh, come on.
says this in Luke 22. He took the bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to them and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take the bread together. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Let's take the cup together. Jesus, we thank you for your body. We thank you for your blood. We thank you for the sacrifice that you made on our behalf, that you died and rose again from the grave, so that you can give us new life. And we honor you today. We trust you today. We give our hope to you today. You are our hope. You are great and greatly to be praised in this place. We worship you. We honor you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's respond. You are love.
Does that not resonate in your heart that our God is great and greatly to be praised? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So great. So great. Whew. So good to be in church this morning. And thank you, Scott, for bringing God's word with such clarity and focus and serving him. Yep. Yep. Don't miss what Scott said. Today is the day of salvation. If you've not ever given your life to Jesus Christ, why not today? And we're going to have people down front. We'd love to talk to you. We'd love to pray with you. If you've got anxieties, you need to cast those upon the Lord. Do it before you leave. And we'd love to say hello if we've not met before. In God's glorious providence, today was planned as a church social in the parking lot on the prettiest day of the year, okay? So this is a great day to hang around a minute. You can show off your bag skills. We got pickleball courts over here. We got food trucks. There's just no need to rush, all right? Great day to hang around, meet a few people. We'd love to do that with you today. Now, we're going to go out on mission for Jesus Christ this week, right? As you do, do not ever forget you are loved.